Staying alive. To keep this story interesting, I'll share with you what I did to ensure my survival. When my brutal attack began, I fought to stay alive. As most do, I thought that maybe it was a foreign country behind it. After all, I worked on secret projects a decade earlier. I wrote the code to track the Soviet nuclear submarine fleet amongst many other government projects. Several times they said they would kill me through a remote-controlled heart attack if I didn't obey or tell them what they wanted to know. I lie on the ground and said I will die for my country to keep what secrets you want. You can imagine the betrayal I felt when I did some basic research. So, I wrote a clever computer virus. It was polymorphic and encrypted so that there was no string a viral scanner could easily identify, and the code kept mutating. I put it on a server that would release it upon my death. The virus was not malicious, it merely directed every computer it infected to a web page that briefly told the plight of thousands in long-duration brutal ultra mind control experimentation using EEG heterodyning. It would remove itself and leave the computer with an inoculant. The server that was to release the virus had to be pinged in a special way by my laptop within a 2-week countdown. It is not illegal to write or study viruses, it is only illegal to release them. But if I were dead, why would I care? This threat might have kept me alive until this book was published. I have since deleted the virus. However, I have asked the publisher to put into my contract that upon my untimely death, incarceration, or disappearance, the copyright of this book is revoked and the work becomes free to distribute to the public. For one who studied economics, they would know the consequences of the price-demand curve for free products. This book is surely an entertaining read whether you are capable of grasping the depravity of our government and the complexity of the truth, or simply read it as a fictitious Orwellian-style prank. The Smoking Man. In the TV series and movie The X-Files, there was a character that seemed to liaison between the conspirators and the FBI agents, Mulder and Scully. It was never revealed why he knew so much, and eventually he dies of lung cancer. The Russians were very open about their research using psychocorrectional methods to try to help alcoholics and drug addicts. The research was very successful. The United States studied just the reverse. They pinpointed the brainwaves of addictions and can amplify those pathways to cause self-destructive behaviors. Most people have heard that there is a high percentage of schizophrenics that smoke. The majority of assassination practice targets that smoke told me that they didn't smoke before the targeting began. In only one case did I find someone who they wanted to stop smoking as a form of control, and they did. Creating alcoholics, smokers, and drug addicts are pull-down menu items of the Satan software. Killing the witnesses with an early death always helps when in 20 years the brutal crimes are revealed and there is no one alive to describe them in detail from a personal account once the mass news media is ready to interview. EDM and false memory implant techniques. Another CIA program that was released to the public many decades ago and is very much wrapped up into the current exaption of directed energy weapons testing on the United States citizens was called EDM, electronic dissolution of memories. It is a technique to accelerate memory decay of previously stored memories and to block short-term memory from becoming long-term memory. The theory is to supply many new stimuli to the memory pathways, thereby, according to neural network theory, overload the network through excessive training samples and thereby decay the information contained in the network. Basically, it is overstimulation of the brain. The short-term memory block is a method like hypnosis to entrain the brain at a base frequency that it is not normally accustomed to operating at. Memories are stored at this new frequency rate, which with hypnotic suggestion can be segmented and blocked from access under the normal brainwave patterns. This is why hypnosis can recover memories from children who were abused under the scalar mind control program. This phenomenon is also observed with psychoactive drugs and is called state-dependent memory. Implanting false memories is done by forcing a memory recall through verbal cues or forced recorded EEG patterns and then revising it with new imagery and associations. Once the false memory has been created, it needs to be reinforced through multiple recalls. Practice makes perfect. In my opinion, this technique doesn't work very well on most people. I only encountered a small number who were severely programmed with false memory implants. Another method of memory erasure uses the grown virtual neurons. Memories are stored holographically and holistically in the brain synaptic weights, not as engrams or single cell instances. When the plug is pulled on the biocommunication signal, the virtual neurons that help store memories disappear too, and information formed during the connection will be very significantly degraded. There will be more on this topic in the biocommunication chapter. Use of torture to harvest the best paranoid evil ideas. I do begin to have bloody thoughts. Shakespeare, The Tempest, IV. 4. 1. Another purpose of the extreme torture of people is to examine the angriest thoughts a person can have and what that person can think of doing to the people and government behind it in their greatest moments of despair. It is a way of seeing what others with extreme hatred of the United States might come up with. My almost finished book on 101 Ways to Take Over the World in 99 Days might have been another reason I was chosen for this kind of mind probing. And finally, it is a way to test whether they have locked up and controlled all the information streams to reach the public. A victim of torture and assassination will quickly realize no one will believe the random acts of long-duration brutality and that there is no one in the government that will help them. I have found other governments to be far more receptive in wanting to learn about the U.S.'s current state-of-the-art mind control weapons that officially don't exist and the CIA interrogation and brainwashing techniques that are not used on random citizens, therefore I could not be divulging any national secrets officially. You can see how dumb this whole thing is. If they are trying to keep secrets from their potential enemies, why is it that they demonstrate all their capabilities on people who then would seek asylum in another country? It is obvious that the only people they are keeping secrets from is the United States public. The making of a Manchurian candidate. The making of a Manchurian candidate or CIA programmed assassin. Isolation and sensory deprivation. Complete breakdown of their happiness until they reach despair. Removal of personality, ego, and sense of individuality through depatterning and humiliation. Fragmentation of personality through torture. Desensitization of violence through imagery and example. Reprogramming fragmented personalities through hypnosis, psychic driving, and Skinnerian techniques to be triggered by words or induced electromagnetically. I caution you not to try this at home. But ironically now, all these steps are done in one's home using the various mind control scripts and biocommunication weapons system. The current program isn't all that different from the movie, Clockwork Orange, except they try to make the psychopathic killer rather than cure one. Reading human resonances absorption spectra through radar. I have respected Carl Sagan, Cosmos, Stephen Hawking's, A Brief History of Time, and Green, An Elegant Universe, for their abilities to explain complex physics concepts in an understandable way to the general reader. I will never be able to reach their level of teaching, but I would like to explain one technique of how brainwaves can be read and influenced by electromagnetic energy. As it turns out, there are many ways in which the seemingly science fiction feat can be done. I will explain a few of them based on patents from the 60s and 70s and then expand on some of those ideas. Let's start with the Malik patent. He never describes the underlying theory as to why his invention works, he just described how to build it and what applications it might be useful for. Imagine the brain being a complex mesh of switches. Initially, let us assume that they are all connected. We then have a structure that can be analogized to a wire mesh. When electromagnetic waves of the electrical resonance frequency of the wire mesh strike it, it absorbs the energy and begins to oscillate like an antenna on your car radio. This is how radar works, by looking at what frequencies bounce back, scatter, get absorbed, or pass through an object. So like a swing that was pushed, it will oscillate back and forth in the electromagnetic spectrum rather than the potential energy spectrum. That oscillation eventually dampens and is converted to kinetic thermal energy. If we disconnect one of the wires in our mesh by throwing a relay, the resonance frequency changes abruptly. It would be like changing the length of the swing's ropes, or when an ice skater pulls in their arms while in a twirl to spin faster. So simply by observing the changes of oscillations of a swing set, we would know the length of the ropes holding it. Or simply by measuring the changes in our oscillating wire mesh, we would know how many switches were connected at any time. Now let us unravel the analogy back to brains. The brain resonates at roughly 450 to 800 MHz in adults, depending on many factors. Basic microwave communication hobbyists have known this for many decades. So if we look at the neuron and what gives rise to the electrical and magnetic fields in the brain, we see that the voltage-sensitive sodium ion gates open and close during the depolarization process. The ion currents act like wired electrical currents and the gates act as switches turning on and off the currents. So the brain, like our wire mesh example above, will resonate according to the state of the ion gates. The phase, amplitude, and frequency of the changing resonance of the brain gives all the information about the brain's ion gates. The return radar signal tells where, when, and how many of these switches are closed and open. This is true with all objects and electrical appliances. Another way to view the problem of reading brain waves at a distance would be to look at the magnetic properties of electron flow. If you model the brain as a coil with inductance, putting a magnetic field near it will change the resonance of the coil or induce a current in it. Ionic flows create magnetic fields which would change the brain's inductance properties. It is just two sides of the same coin. There is only one force in the universe with many expressions of it due to dimensional dilation that we observe as electric, magnetic, weak, strong, and gravity. Activity can be read through radar nor the heart beating through hole. Body or organ resonance in a similar fashion. Other additional signal processing methods like Doppler radar adds another perspective. Even muscle contractions have similar ionic switches that can be measured. Disinformation agents, like Dr. Delgado, Colonel Bearden, and Colonel Alexander, would like you to believe their versions of science so you can join the ranks of the unenlightened but don't fall for it. The certain government agencies that like to keep secrets from the cattle they are testing their weapons on, will do or say anything to keep these secrets of basic physics. It isn't surprising that a major defense contractor in microwave antenna design rediscovered a mind-reading and influencing radar technique given that they are experts with antenna resonance designs. Now for the more unintuitive part. It has become common folklore in culture that brainwaves cannot be read by satellites. The people who claim this and the other technology secrets have been exiled to the land of paranoids and the mentally ill. While satellites are used for the infrared imaging and visual imaging portions of the integrated global surveillance system, they are not the most probable source and antenna for reading of human biosignatures. The disinformation agents have been so successful with this campaign that the mere mention of the technology to government agencies will have you locked up in a psych ward for 3 days to add insult to injury for those experimented on. Let's look at the mathematics and physics behind this possibility though. Perhaps the uneducated and programmed within the policing function or justice system can understand some basic mathematics and physics and come to another conclusion. Just using back of the envelope calculations, we can show the feasibility of these technologies being done by a constellation of satellites or a large phased array of terrestrial antenna. Fact number 1, squid transformers have a sensitivity of 10 to 15 teslas or 10 to 32 joules. They can measure the smallest detectable change in a second or equivalently the work required to raise a single electron 1 millimeter in the Earth's gravitational field. Fact number 2, there are over 100 satellites available for remote sensing the terrestrial landscape in the sky at any time. Fact number 3, we will use 1,000 miles as the average Earth orbiting micro constellation of spy satellites' average altitude. Satellites orbit between 600 miles to 28,000 miles above the Earth. Fact number 4, the brain gives off a few femtoteslas of magnetic flux. The heart gives off 50,000 feet. A depolarizing neuron at its surface creates 70 millivolts and an average ionic current of amps. The brain's electrical activity at the surface of the scalp is in tens of microvolts. Fact number 5, a small dipole antenna, piece of metal, cut to operate at 402 MHz like the ones removed from many alien abductees radiates 2.5 milliwatts from the head and 1.25 milliwatts if implanted in the chest if that person is radiated with 1 watt of power. Biotelemetry and neural telemetry are well-studied fields but science fiction to the general public. Cell phones deliver 5 watts to the head. And peak pulse power of alien signals I have been told deliver 30 watts to the human body but average power levels are still within SAR-safe thresholds. First let's approach it from an implant perspective. Also assume we know the exact location of the target of interest. Since there are so many target tracking methods used in the military systems, this is a reasonable assumption. 2.5 x 10-3 watts will weaken by the square of the distance if radiated equally in all directions. So the needed sensitivity by a satellite would be 2.5 x 10-3/1000 miles x 1.6129 x 103 meters / mile, 2, x 100 satellites. Equals 9.61 x 10-14 watts or 9.61 x 10-14 joules per second. So that's within 15 orders of magnitude plausible. Or one could state that in the pentahertz wavelength, 1 x 10-15 seconds, enough energy could be detected. That extends all the way into the ultraviolet spectrum. That's an easy feat with just one squid transformer satellite. In fact, just a constellation of large antennas would do the trick. But triangulation precision would be a must. With 100 satellites, you could precisely pinpoint and track that person and read the brainwaves or heartbeat with alien biotelemetric antenna implants. But I remind you, that ground-based mile-long phased arrays bounced off the ionosphere is the most likely source since superconductivity was not discovered until after the first government neurological torture testing began in the early 1960s. So how can so many people be monitored and tracked by such a system? If the source is correct, 25 million people can be tracked and controlled through the brain/machine interface. If brain waves don't extend much beyond 2 kHz, then a time multiplexing scheme like what cellular phone transmitters use would work. 25 million asterisk 2 kHz equals 50 GHz for the upper bandwidth requirements. Currently published radar capabilities go into the terahertz frequency range or submillimeter wavelength well within the bandwidth required. In fact, the entirety of human intelligence of the planet without compression operates at 1.34 terahertz, 6.7 billion people asterisk 2 kHz. In the last few decades, implants have become less popular with the subhumans and aliens for their experimentation. In the X-Files, Scully removed her alien implant and got cancer shortly afterwards. Was that a threat by the aliens to the implanted human slaves? The shadow government will kill you with plausible denial if you remove the implants, I think is the undertone. I am happy to report that I have seen and met with many victims of government torture and mind control experimentation that have removed their implants with only beneficial results. Makes you proud to be in the land of the free to know this stupidity and corruption still exists at higher levels today than when they were feeding radiation to people and dosing them with LSD randomly. So can bio and neural telemetry be done without an implanted dipole or microstrip antenna? RFID chips have shrunk to the size of a grain of rice. But, are they necessary at all? No, not according to full spectrum radar signature analysis or according to the Malik patent. Just the changes in the brain resonances due to ion channeling is easily detectable from a return signal from these radar and other surveillance method sources with many orders of magnitude sensitivity to spare. The math does not lie, no matter how unintuitive it is. You can get a sense of the sensitivity of the technology just by observing the edges of the universe, 9 billion light years away, with pictures from the Hubble Space Telescope. You can get a hold of infrared imaging done during battle in Iraq on the internet. These images show the thermal heat of bodies causing photon emissions due to thermal instabilities with vibrating molecules. There is no radar energy pulse to light them up. It is not necessary in that part of the spectrum. You can clearly see the person's entire body lit up at great distances due to black body radiation. Now imagine that the body electricity caused the body to heat slightly in proportion to the voltage at the surface of the skin. This isn't true, but the thought experiment will help you understand what the images would look like for the surveillance operators. You would very easily see the person flickering in the infrared spectrum and be able to demodulate the intensity of the flickering into brain waves, heartbeat, and muscle flexing. Well, this is what is happening in other parts of the spectrum that we don't usually see as an image. That is what can be seen by the giant eye reflected in the sky. That is what is meant by full spectrum imaging. It provides an incredibly clear view of all energy emissions from every point on the landscape when energy in every frequency is directed at it. The entire Earth is viewed this way. All life forms can easily be tracked. Using the signatures of all the waves lengths as well as body/brain resonances and heartbeat rhythm, individuals can be tracked anywhere. Everyone has a unique body resonance signature, heartbeat signature, and brain wave print. No RFID chip or dipole antenna is needed anymore to do biotelemetry. Another point of reference to radar sensitivity can be seen with commercial weather satellite radar, which can detect birds or even insects. It is so frustrating to see such ignorance amongst the psychology community, policing community, and FBI. It is difficult to get people up to speed in science and technology if they don't have an interest and are already biased or programmed with disinformation. Psychic warfare has been going on for 4 decades, mostly practiced on the citizens. Using the psychology community to discredit victims of the practice kills and mind control programming, they have successfully been able to keep the truth of the technology under wraps and a taboo to even mention without the immediate conditioned response of that person is crazy who dares speak of cutting-edge neural telemetry and psychophysics. If all these groups of people live long enough, they will see in 24 years the technology will be suddenly discovered or released by the DOD. Maybe we were wrong about all those people pleading for help, might cross their minds. I wasted my career misdiagnosing all those people, might be another thought. I didn't serve justice or uphold the Constitution. What a waste of life I was, perhaps might be thought by some others. Stupid alien tricks. This childish government assassin, I mean evil alien, would often say, "Quit hitting yourself." And then he would slap himself lightly, which would make me slap myself lightly. Remember when you were a kid wrestling with someone stronger than you and they would grab your arm and make you hit yourself? Yes, the aliens enjoy that game too and doing it remotely. This capability probably inspired the movie, Fight Club. e.g. heterodyning is the ghost in the military machine. Just in case you are still wondering why we have terrorism at all or why we are called the Great Satan by many countries, just be reminded of articles published in major newspapers such as the February 14, 1992 USA Today, who reported allegations by Saddam Hussein that the CIA targeted him, the CIA used psychotronics and biocommunication to cause a blood clot in the brain or heart. We even have laws that say we cannot assassinate leaders of other countries. We have turned into a criminal state in which Congress is impotent to enforce the laws without an army of their own. Satan, silent assassination through amplified neurons, has many applications for pissing people off and creating lifelong enemies. Even the European Parliament documented this fact about the psychological effects of psychotronics after Desert Storm. Almost every country in the world is aware of the U.S.'s use of psychotronic weapons around the world except the United States citizens. Sadly, our government has decided to make us the most uneducated and politically ignorant nation of the so-called first world countries through an embarrassing public education system and perpetual lying to us due to national security. We have all sorts of laws that say the CIA and NSA can't spy on the United States citizens and human experimentation is banned, but who can enforce the laws if the executive branch is corrupt, illegal, and illegitimate? Classification of non-lethal directed energy weapons. It is such a joke to call an ineffective killing weapon non-lethal. It is like classifying guns as non-lethal because the bullet doesn't kill the person. It is all the hemorrhaging that does. The bleeding is a secondary effect. E.g. cloning and non-lethal directed energy weapons do the same thing just over a much longer time frame and much more painfully. It is like trying to kill someone with a butter knife. It is more difficult, takes a lot longer, and will hurt a hell of a lot more. More system flaws with TAMI. In the world of psychic warfare, things are not black or white. Compatibility of minds, time spent locked on for adapting, a database brain match, and susceptibility of the target to the power levels of directed energy all are factors in the successfulness of a psychic attack. For example, bilingual victims have all reported that if they start speaking another language, the psychic attackers can't understand what they are saying nor can the AI language recognition system correctly predict their sentences. This is only true for fairly fluent people who don't need to translate the meanings of words in their heads. Attacking the chain of command. Let's ponder the power of EEG heterodyning as a weapon. In a hierarchy of command where people cannot question authority, how many people's minds would you have to influence to take control of the whole structure? 1. Everyone else's orders come from him/her. This assumes that no one is bold enough to question the orders, of course. So military command structures are extremely vulnerable to a takeover. There are few safeguards to watch them or question them, especially if the secrecy directive is used. How many people need to be controlled or influenced to take over Congress? How about the judicial branch? Not many, and the whole country would then follow suit. The masses might get suspicious if things seem too unusual and not in line with the Constitution. So you might need to take over the media. How many mass news information streams are there? So the Russians were right. If you could control less than 10,000 people, maybe even fewer than 2,000 people, you could steer the direction of the whole country. Is it smart to keep this technology a secret from the population so that they can't recognize the symptoms of a takeover? Is it smart to not build zero-emission superconducting shelters in case of an attack on the public? Who is defending us? Why the F do we have a military and security agencies who can't do their jobs? Is it incompetence, or treason? Other limitations of TAMI. When I was brain-napped, I was told that I had to slow down my thinking, speak in complete sentences, and think aloud in words. Apparently my brain was of interest because when they EEG cloned my mind onto theirs, they could only pick up vision, sound, and the senses but not my higher level thoughts. They were interested in mapping my brain waves more completely to add to their database. Having a fast mind means that there is not time for the amplification of the brain entrainments to be induced in the psychic spy. This is also somewhat true with vision. If one scans the surroundings quickly, the cloner sees a blurring of images. Humor break a riddle. So what's a book about the darkest times in human and American history without some riddles to solve? In the spirit of Batman, where the Riddler tries to mind control the world, I riddle you this: when I began being mind probed and interrogated, I asked for help from every federal government agency. I was concerned that just maybe the Russians were actually behind it given my background and would extract the secrets that I hold. I got no response from hundreds of letters including from the Navy, which I hold the most secrets. So I am their destroyer. Who am I? Why, The Matrix. Why was the movie, The Matrix, called that? Is it a reference to the global grid to which several kernels I worked with for DARPA projects refer? Isn't the global grid just the internet of networked information? I believe it is a reference to the image matrix calculated with MRI/ESR techniques. Like I mentioned before, I found a Yale professor who has been doing Earth gauze intensity MRIs since the late 60s. Generally high-powered superconducting magnets are used in hospital MRIs. This is because they need high resolution and fast imaging techniques. Under a weak magnetic field, the same principles apply, but the time to acquire an image is greater and the resolution is far less. But you could map out the entire Earth this way, especially if you combine it with radar techniques. Perhaps it is a reference to the matrix algebra that is used for hyper-fast complex algorithms such as calculating a cognitive model of the human brain. Perhaps the movie, The Matrix, was named from interferometry techniques. If you intersect three perpendicular coherent, linearly polarized electromagnetic sources, you create a matrix of constructive and destructive interference patterns. Altering the frequencies would cause the matrix to roll or scan. A multi-frequency radar imaging that tries to balance the return signal from all directions of a target by increasing the strength of the signals accordingly would create scalar waves or an invisible electromagnetic interferometric matrix all around the target. Directed energy. There is a medical instrument called the gamma knife used to focus X-rays from all angles around the head to burn tumors in the brain without cutting open the skull. At the intersection of these gamma rays, the energy is intense enough to kill the tumor cells while harmlessly passing through the other brain matter. Only at the intersection is the combined energy deadly. GPS, global positioning system, works on the same principle, except one calculates position from the timing of the satellite pulses, which arrive at slightly different times. 2MW*100 satellites asterisk, a beam width of 1/100 of 360 degrees, equals 454 mW of pulse peak power over a large area. Shrink the beam width to 1/1000 of 360 degrees, equals 45 watts of power over that area. This is more than plenty to affect neurons. The Russian Radio Electronics Institutes published back in the 70s that with only 10 watts up to 100 mW/cm2 of microwave energy, they observed all kinds of different effects on the firing groups of neurons. Again, this back of the envelope calculation says it is quite possible to have satellite-based neurological weapons. At first blush, it sounded like Star Wars science fiction, didn't it? However, this was just an exercise. Satellites are better sensors than powerful emitters. It would make more sense to use giant radar fields known as ionospheric heaters to bounce their phase 10 gigawatt energy fields off the atmosphere back to spots on Earth. Similarly, one could use extremely high-powered directed energy weapons from satellites to converge their energy onto one point using phased array beam steering or high-powered masers. Ignoring the obvious assassination application, it can be used to increase the resolution of MRI/ESR and other imaging techniques. At the intersection, the phase/frequency/amplitude is calculated such that the full energy for a duration of time is maximized in the magnetic field by modulating a very low sideband and destructively heterodyning the beam's high-frequency carriers. During that increased magnetic field, another radio or higher frequency signal can be used for the excitation of the electron spins or magnetic nuclei for the relaxation photons to be collected and viewed. This would be better than just using the natural Earth's magnetic field for increased resolution. Seems like another science fiction feat, doesn't it? But just look at the infrared image resolution of the Air Force's AC-130S 5 miles from their targets. This energy is emitted by thermally generated collisions of vibrating molecules without any external energy to excite it. If every valence electron or nucleus could be prodded to give off a photon in a similar fashion, the landscape and people would be easily reconstructible into a three-dimensional image, that is Earth-penetrating tomography, an application of the ionospheric heaters. Here is another brain teaser for you. Suppose you have two laser beams with perfect monochromatic, one frequency, and coherent, in phase, wave fronts. The beams each enter a cube made of two right-angle prisms. The cube acts to combine the beams and project it onto a screen. One laser is moved one half wavelength further from the cube than the other. If one laser is operational, you will see a spot on the screen. But if they are both operational, you will not. Why? Where does the energy go? Why is this relevant? It demonstrates how to make pinpoint high-energy waves anywhere on Earth via directed energy weapons with constructive interference of energy sources. All sorts of interesting effects can be done with these sorts of weapons. from being able to induce electronic machines to behave a certain way, for example, or to destroy their circuitry with high-powered M or microwave pulses. Destructive interference mode beams, like in the laser example above, create scalar waves that can travel tremendous distances with high-intensity fields without burning the object of interest and reflect back with tremendous signal-to-noise ratio. More on this technique later. Hypergeeking, the concepts behind the most top-secret global human surveillance and manipulation systems. Synthetic aperture radar and beam steering. All these concepts of directed energy are just rebranding marketing jargon for half a century old concept, except with more power. Grids of transducers or antenna can shape the wave front by phase controlling the individual elements in the grid. The beam can be shaped wider by using lower frequencies or narrower by using high frequencies. It can be steered 360 degrees and its intensity, whether in constructive or destructive modes, can be controlled. The carrier signals in the beams can be modulated and shaped with ELF waves or heterodyned into high-frequency side lobes. That is it behind the concepts of scalar scatter radar and directed energy systems. Time reverse echo. Time reverse echo is a technique which can be used to send a signal back to the source even if the location of the source is undetermined due to multiple reflections. By using a phased array of microphones or antenna, the signal is collected and rebroadcast in the reverse time sequence the signal arrived. The phased array signal will bounce off all the same structures to combine and arrive at the source at the same time. If you amplify the return signal, you could potentially attack a signal source this way once it is identified from a signature. This technique was written about in Scientific America, and the principle would probably work in any medium. One could envision arrays of transducers on the ocean floor that could send out jamming sonar or high-powered directed sonic waves that would deafen occupants in submarines listening to ocean sounds, shake the hull of the water vessel, create cavitations in the turbines to stall it, or act like a lithotripter and from a calculated energy propagation or resonance pattern of direct mechanical energy to locations within the water vehicle to cause structural or mechanical failure. I have never heard of any research in this area of directed pressure waves as a weapon, but maybe that's what has been causing so many whales to beach themselves. Neuron induction and brainwave modulation techniques. Scalar ELF brain modulation using magnetic field induction or electric field modulation. Roche video for CNN. Bird. Resonances standing microwaves using FDTD modeling of humans. Using Malik and Stockland's brain resonance frequency modulators. Nanoparticles and designer biochemistry. Neuronal amplification technology. It was discovered back in 1920s that neurons could be influenced by electromagnetic induction. This technology has been held in the strictest top secret clearance government labs since then as it was developed. Only now are universities exploring it as a tool for curing depression and quelling the voices of schizophrenics, Yale, and University of Pennsylvania. The population was being prepped for the human efficacy trials even as far back as the 1960s. The television series, The Outer Limits, features mind control, synthetic telepathy, and evil alien experimentation in almost every episode. It is simply easier for people to cope with the idea of evil aliens than high treason and being betrayed by the government of a country that they are ready to die for to uphold the ideals of the doctrines. The mass programming through popular media has continued to this day to seed the ideas that these high-technology experiments of mind are conducted on behalf of a secret evil alien plot. I have tried my best to avoid scientific details of these technologies that are often ungraspable by the general public. But at this time we must use the magnifying glass to examine the details to garner clues to solve the world's biggest mystery. In this case, we need to scrutinize the psychophysics term of choice. Choice occurs at the moment of neuron depolarization. It is the summation of synaptic potentials at the hillock which determines whether a depolarization is warranted. There are a plethora of biological mechanisms which can be affected by electromagnetic forces that would alter this moment of choice. Affecting the neurotransmitter release, voltage potential across the membrane, the voltage-sensitive organelles on the cell membrane responsible for conductance, or any ionic current flow in the biochemical mechanisms would achieve the desired neural influence. Remember that biochemical sensitizers can increase the electromagnetic influence in these mechanisms. The key to influencing a neuron and the entire informational structure of the mind is in the timing of the pulses of electromagnetic signals. Using just EEG probes is generally not enough to determine the timing. One needs to precisely time each neuron's interaction with the next throughout the whole structure at the moment of choices. This is why electromagnetic energy doesn't send everyone into seizures. It is only in the informational coherence of the signal specific to each individual that matters. Everyone has different axon lengths and hence timings of potential amplification of external electromagnetic influence. This is the reason that the ever-growing database of TAMI must be maintained for maximal effectiveness on the world's population. The synapse of a neuron has been analogized to Medusa's head. It looks like a bunch of snakes extruding from the body of the neuron. Be careful not to stare directly at the science or you will be turned to stone, menticized like a zombie. Neurotransmitter release with specific frequencies and power levels. So, for argument's sake, let's say that the Air Force documents that I published in the appendix of this book are true and not meant to look like an accidental misclassification of a top secret weapon, and the Russian literature from their radio and electronic institutes are true too. Then neurotransmitter release occurs at specific power absorption and under certain frequencies. E.g. heterodyning, which causes neuron amplification, could be done in this way. Why are certain people chosen around the world for these endless tortures and extermination? Directed energy might work like the Stanford gamma knife. Only at the intersection of several power pulses does the neurotransmitter release occur. Perhaps certain individuals exceed an allowable sensitivity that is used for communicating with spies and need to be terminated for that reason. Perhaps everyone is monitored by a specific program and those that get classified as psychics become too sensitive and start picking up other people's monitoring signals or programs and need to be terminated or psychotronically imprisoned for that reason. It is only speculation what the rationale the traitors use to justify why they do this, but the illusion of freedom is crumbling. No illusion is 100% containable. Perhaps we are chosen on the human surveillance global grid as one of the 1,000 points of light to be human property of the DOD. If Congress were to order another independent investigation as has been done several times in the past, documents would be shredded and the cowards scrambling to the shadows. All the countries in the world need to stand up and say enough is enough. We will not allow you to pick us off one by one like cattle with your mind control weapons, manipulate our politics, and instigate wars, just so the machine can justify growth like a cancer over the planet. Many will have trouble accepting this basic research. But it does not detract from the truth of it. The educated will at least see the plausibility of it and if they have time investigate it further. In a nutshell, direct the energy for the correct power level, time the pulses to the individual's cognitive model for synaptic transmission in the state-dependent time sequence. Why is this concept so difficult for academics to understand and catch up with the aliens in their research? Brain-reading satellites and ionospheric heater radar fields. To give you an idea of power density and sensitivity of instruments, let's consider an FM radio station 20 miles away emitting 50 kilowatts of power. The receiver would only measure 2.1 x 10 to 5 W/m2. That's what your car radio receives, demodulates, and amplifies for your listening pleasure. A 1 terahertz submillimeter wavelength radio antenna such as the 10-meter Heinrich Hertz telescope can view a typical radio source intensity of 10 to 26 W/m2 through the Earth's atmosphere. Do you still believe that radar brain resonances cannot be read by satellite radio telescopes? How the electromagnetic sensing systems work together. Any ground-based network like HARP, GWEN, cell phone towers or the Russian woodpeckers could also perform this feat of mind reading and control, but not on a global scale. Only through the hundreds of spy and remote sensing satellites circling the Earth and the tens of giant ionospheric phased array fields could you cover the entire globe with directed energy weapons and the subset class of mind control weapons. Imagine a steerable beam using a phased array of transmitters. This is similar to a mechanical method of using a mirror to deflect a laser beam like for laser light shows, except it requires no moving parts. The intensity of the beam and all other participating satellite beams can converge on one spot or many spots simultaneously. This would be directed energy whose intensity is supposed to be enough to fry the electronics in anything not radiation hard shielded. It might heat a human being, but I don't believe the effects can be made immediately lethal by the thermal effects alone, otherwise Saddam Hussein would not have complained about the biocommunication directed energy weapon torturing him in 92. He would have been fried like the rest of us. The torture just pisses people off if they can't kill you through menticide. Notice how we had to fight another war after we used it on him. The European Parliament commented on the non-lethal and mind control weapons in general and stated they need to be banned because they only instigate wars and increase violence. The United States refuses to sign any treaties or acknowledge them to their own citizens. Welcome to the land of freedom, where you are free to believe all the lies your government tells you. The grid of satellites in the hemisphere or the ionospherically reflected ground-based miles-wide antenna fields can be used in a time-sliced manner or calculate an inverse Fourier transform to attack many people at the same time without exposing too many others to the same intensity and frequencies. All the sensor systems are integrated to act as one single antenna or phased array. This allows the link system to redirect energy from almost any angle to find a weakness in a shielded structure. Remember in the Malik patent it said that frequencies between 10 MHz and 40 GHz could be used for mind reading radar. That's a huge range and may extend even higher in the spectrum. Different frequencies have different ability to penetrate different materials and structures. Full spectrum radar sends a broadband ping across all frequencies like a flash of white light from a camera, and records all the returns across the area. Each person has a unique set of frequencies that they will absorb or return to the sensor arrays. This uniquely identifies everyone. Based on autocorrelation techniques, one can determine the optimal route and frequencies to be emitted by the phased arrays of antenna to optimally modulate the brain waves of the target. By finding the weaknesses of shielding or barriers by using any frequency or path, there would be few defenses against a nervous system disruptor that targets individuals. When Dan Rather was beaten up by directed energy weapon torture victims, they kept asking, "What is the frequency, Kenneth?" Everyone looks for the frequencies that the illegitimate CIA and DOD elements are using to torture them, but it is nearly impossible to isolate them with a budget under $1 million. Especially if they can use narrowband or broadband in such a large spectrum. The patent claims you can use pulsed or continuous wave. It would be easy to devise a frequency hopping scheme so that the pattern would not stand out, or use deterministic broadband noise to diabolically hide the informational coherence. On top of that, who would recognize brainwaves modulated into a frequency hopping scheme? We are bathed in electromagnetic energy and I have yet to see a successfully built full-spectrum anechoic M chamber. Diagram of satellite energy hitting many points on the US. Diagram of penetrating shielding. What other advantages do scalar waves have? They can penetrate materials to a greater degree since the electromagnetic energy doesn't get absorbed by the surfaces. Remember that electromagnetic waves reflect, scatter, get absorbed, or transmit through any material with these different parameters. A perfect scalar wave will no absorption in the material, so more will get through, allow one to penetrate to greater depths with high energy radar. Some refer to this as ground penetrating radar. Diagram of frequency hopping brainwave encoded pulses. Why is it difficult to detect scalar waves? They exist as pure field potential, some call this a gravity wave. Separating the sources of the interference requires a radio telescope with enough resolving power. There are other techniques that disinformers and Tesla junkies call free energy machines that try to extract the scalar wave energy in which the global surveillance system bathes our planet. The extra energy the humans absorb is only supposed to increase the risk of cancer by 5%. You do the math of how many people the aliens are killing each year while watching and protecting us. Here is a diagram of what a scalar wave looks like. Diagram of a person within a destructive interference fringe of electromagnetic energy. So the question that it raises is, do the energy sensors still pick up an object in an interference fringe? With just one source alone they would. People might believe that you could penetrate solid objects this way if it didn't interact with the object. If the scalar field can penetrate the shielding, this would be a large distance quantum tunneling effect. This is an outstanding question for the scientific community for civilian defenses. This is the basis of the top secret scalar weapons that have so many disinformation agents confusing people in the scientific community and are the basis for menticizing and silently assassinating people without easily being detected. So I will leave the answer for you to discover it on your own. Get a laser and create a Michelson interferometer whose beams completely interferes with each other destructively. Place a photodiode in the path or a piece of film and see what happens. Now place a piece of thin black film at the perfectly destructive interference path and measure the intensity at different points behind it. That will answer whether the photons can penetrate a shield while the waves seem to be non-existent because of averaging. Stealthy isn't is. This is the paradox between waves and photons that baffle our intuitive senses. Interfacing TAMI. TAMI's interface has three screens for the operator. The interface uses an eye tracker instead of a mouse, keyboard, or touch screen. TAMI's operator needs only look at one spot on the screen for a second, then a drop-down X Windows-driven menu system allows the operator to traverse the options merely by looking at them. It turns out to be a very efficient way to operate the program. The developers experimented with voice recognition, but this turned out to have some issues with coveredness. The eye tracking system is also necessary in light of the fact that an EEG clone target would catch on more quickly what was happening to them if they were tapping their fingers all the time. Instead, the extra eye movement has already been covered up by the strategic disinformation agents in the psychology community. I found a paper that said people who are schizophrenic have a very unusual extra rapid eye movement. Nicely done, agents. The left screen shows the operator's brain frequency energy spectrum next to the targets, and underneath is the combined. The center screen is used to select the tortures and other brain modulation scenarios. The third screen is workspace and used for the psychic training games I described earlier, or the truth detector brain printing analyzer program. Show screenshots from front cover. Creating powerful and directed ELF, extremely low frequency, magnetic and electric fields using single sideband, heterodyned UHF beams. Diagram of UHF waves arriving at a point and creating a longer waveform using exponential wave amplitude fronts. Stupid alien tricks. We covered a lot of science, but we had to get through it so that the doubt is removed that this weapon system exists, so we can move on to the more important implications of it on society. Let's take a break for a moment and watch the fools entertain us. We're going to crush your head and punch you in the stomach, the agents say. I feel a pressure on my head and a nauseating wrenching in my gut. They tell me that their head hurts because they squeeze too hard. Where can you find so many dumb aliens that would hurt themselves to hurt others? I'll give you one guess where mindless obedience comes from. Scalar weapons, creating high-intensity ELF magnetic and electric fields through heterodyning high-frequency directed energy weapons. This is a trick that seems quite astounding when you see it. That is the ability to direct enough energy at an extremely low frequency to spin a compass needle or create a voltage gradient seemingly out of thin air. We intuitively think that there needs to be a near-field physical object present to create the kind of magnetic or electric field strength to accomplish this, but with the giant ionospheric heaters phased array fields this feat can be done. Puerto Rico's and Brazil's are very much within range and operational within the time frame that most ships and planes were lost in the Bermuda Triangle. During the past century, more than 50 ships and 20 aircraft sailed into oblivion in the area known as the Devil's Triangle, Bermuda Triangle, and Hoodoo Sea. The satanic cults or naval weapons testers have been operating for a long time, conducting warfare exercises on their own ships and civilian crafts. Here is how I believe the scalar directed energy weapons can spin a compass needle. During the heaviest attacks by the ghosts, I say sarcastically, they actually spun several compasses needles 360 degrees. They quit demonstrating this trick once I set up Hall effect high sensitivity magnetic sensors around my house to record the fields 24 hours of day. I have video of a compass needle oscillating 45 degrees from true magnetic north at roughly 0.3 Hz for 10 minutes. Let's simplify the model to get a better grasp of it. If you created two beams from two beam steered phased array fields which bounce their very intense UHF beams off the ionosphere to intersect at an area the size of a small neighborhood block, you would have roughly 10 gigawatts of energy to work with. You can only create tight beams with high frequencies. Raw low frequencies emitters create very wide beams. This is true for sound waves as well. But you can create a mixed or heterodyned intersection point that has very low frequencies if the high frequencies are exactly cancelled out. This is how directional ultrasonic heterodyning sound projection is done, to project a voice into one person's head with sound waves without the person next to them hearing it. So one high-powered UHF beam contains the very low-frequency information and the other just contains the same UHF carrier without the low-frequency component, but it is 180 degrees out of phase at the intersection point. What is left is an extremely low-frequency, high-intensity, magnetic and electric field that seems to come out of thin air and be directionless, that is a scalar field. But in fact it does have direction, it just can't easily be measured. If airplanes still used compasses rather than laser gyroscopes to fly, they could be disoriented and made to crash this way, or ships to go off course. But the Bermuda Triangle seems to have quit taking lives once GPS and gyroscopic navigation instrument have been the common instrumentation method. Of course, GPS signals could be fooled by these kind of signal attacks too. Gyroscopes are immune to these directed energy attacks. As a good college level physics problem, I will leave the math up to the reader. What is the power required to counter the Earth's natural magnetic field of 0.5 gauss over a neighborhood block? Determine the low-frequency power component of a high-intensity UHF signal modulated with it. You will find that it falls well within the upper bounds of the so-called ionospheric heater phased array high-powered directed energy fields. For more advanced students, write your own Maxwell equation solver. You might want to use the numerical approximation method of finite differential time domain, FDTD, to do it. Run the simulations as described above to simulate scalar interferometry and convince yourself that it can be done at these power levels. Let's say that Colonel Thomas Bearden's gravity wave free energy device that collected 75 watts of power was 100% efficient and used a 1 square foot gravity wave collection dish, which is about the area of the head and body viewed from above. That means the average scalar scatter radar energy passing through a person is roughly 70 milliwatts per centimeter squared. That is exactly the range the Russian university papers describe altering neuronal group firings coincidentally. And for the professional physicist, estimate of how many coulombs of gyrosynchronized electrons are needed per unit area under 70 milliwatts per centimeter squared intensity radar beam to read the bioelectric field given a known noise background and an antenna field the size of HARP. Next, how many electrons need to be jostled to disable the surveillance technique and at what rate? You can see why plasma research is so popular at NASA and DARPA. This is very good evidence that while satellites could perform the same trick, they would have difficulty generating that kind of power continuously from solar panels. This is extremely good news for the thousands that are tortured by these systems each year. See the section on antipsychotronic theory for more details. That means the killing signals have an exact direction that can be calculated by ray tracing your location to the ionosphere back to the 4 or 5 directed energy antenna fields aka over the horizon radar. Those are the directions you want to block to weaken the nervous system disruptor or the surveillance system secondary effects for electrically sensitive individuals. Hiding the scalar killing signals, that is low probability of interception radar. Not only do the scalar waves look like they are coming out of nowhere, the carrier frequency can be what is called deterministic broadband noise. Deterministic broadband noise is a signal that appears just like noise across some bandwidth of a broad spectrum, let's say HF-UHF for example. It is calculated from a uniform random distribution function. It is really just a deterministic, very complex function that looks just like true random noise. It will appear like regular noise to an amateur signal analyst looking at an oscilloscope or spectrum analyzer. The background noise levels will be just a bit higher, and most amateur radio engineers do not keep measurements on the absolute background noise levels. This very complex broadband carrier wave will be cancelled out at the point of intersection of a scalar wave anyway. So this is how you can hide the carrier wave of the signal in noise and hide the direction and carrier wave frequencies of the signal with heterodyning destructive interference, that is scalar waves. The reverse is true too. You can create a high-frequency coherent signal at the intersection of directed energy wave fronts that would increase the bandwidth by the addition of the frequency sources. This too could be a combination of several deterministic broadband noise signal carriers. If one signal was intercepted, it would appear like noise. Only at the intersection of the many signal sources can the message be deciphered and will be automatically decoded through nature's signal addition arriving at the correct time, phase, and amplitude. So the upper bounds of the bandwidth of the psychotronic attack signals would be the maximum frequency that can be bounced off the ionosphere at the angle from the 3 or 4 radar fields added together. Scalar interferometric stealth radar aka scatter radar. How does stealthy scatter radar work in terms of low probability of interception? You must remember two facts to understand scalar scatter radar. Photons reflect off of surfaces at 90 degree angles and they do not convert to other photon types during flight, except off-course Doppler shifting due to relativistic effects of space dilation or contraction and reflecting off moving objects. Beaming two coherent, monochromatic photon streams at an object 180 degrees out of phase with very little difference in intensity will render the measurable energy at the intersecting path nearly zero in terms of its combined electromagnetic field, but the photons still exist and continue their flight path and reflection points, which can be read accordingly through phase angle filtering or where the beams no longer intersect at a distance. This technique is especially useful if a tracking lock has occurred and the target's location is already known. Using time of flight filtering and Doppler shifting to update location adds to the precision of all low probability of detection radar imaging techniques. In the reverse mode of constructive interference, all the intersecting beams would add their intensity together and maximum energy transference to objects would occur. How does this relate to mind reading radar? The Russians first used scatter radar on the United States Embassy in Moscow. The microwaves used to collect the brain resonance changes and electron spin resonances were scalars from phased arrays. The microwave energy was still detectable and far from a perfect scalar. But the measurable microwave energy could have been the influence signal necessary to affect brainwave modulation. Putting deflecting screens on the building actually increased the energy readings. This is because if you block one path of two intersecting beams, the full energy of one of the beams will be measured as well as confine the scalar energy that penetrated the walls then separated into their individual paths. Once the beam path separate out of a scalar, the energy has more difficulty escaping back through the walls and windows, now with screens on them. Synthetic telepathy and microwave hearing effect. There is actually a subtle difference between these two communication modes called synthetic telepathy and microwave hearing effect. The microwave hearing effect is thought to heat the brain slightly and cause a pressure wave to the inner ear, according to Dr. Lin for the University of Illinois. Other microwave hearing devices claim that they stimulate the auditory nerves, and a third claims it stimulates the brain cells in the auditory cortex using microwaves. This is the crossover point to synthetic telepathy. The microwave hearing effect is often used during the brain mapping processes. Words are stimulated to be heard, and the automated mapping software records the whole brain patterns that are triggered by that word. So meanings of words are now mapped to the sounds. Synthetic telepathy uses both the direct stimulation of the audio cortex and word association brain areas for brain-to-brain communication. It is a far more accurate and efficient way to convey ideas and thoughts without misinterpretations. The pulsed microwave audiograms are heard as sound, but usually needs background noise to be heard, giving the illusion that the source of the background sound is the source of the pulsed audiogram transmission. During my time as an unpaid quality assurance engineer for EEG heterodyning experimentation, I was able to achieve pure thought communication based on word meaning without internal voice or microwave hearing transmissions. It is creepy to be that close to someone else's mind. While speaking a different language throws off the other hive mind participants and the sentence completion software, it doesn't entirely prevent thought reading, because words are mapped to concepts and meanings, and those are conveyed if a good mind mapping has been achieved. See the promised land for the universal translator concept. http://www.the.cc/contents/more/archive/sound_as_weapon.html. Communicating via the microwave auditory effect is the title of a small business contract for the Department of Defense. Communication initial results are, the feasibility of the concept has been established using both low and high power systems. A Freedom of Information Act, FOIA, request as to the project's outcome met with denial on the part of the Air Force, on the grounds that disclosure could reasonably be expected to cause damage to national security. Though the Air Force denied this FOIA disclosure, such a contract's purpose is elaborated by the Air Force's New World Vistas report. It would also appear possible to create high-fidelity speech in the human body, raising the possibility of covert suggestion and psychological direction. If a pulse stream is used, it should be possible to create an internal acoustic field in the 5 to 15 kHz range, which is audible. Thus it may be possible to talk to selected adversaries in a fashion that would be most disturbing to them. Robert O. Becker, whose eminence was enough to have been twice nominated for the Nobel Prize in Biological Electromagnetic Fields Research, is explicit regarding clandestine use. Such a device has obvious applications in covert operations designed to drive a target crazy with voices or deliver undetectable instructions to a programmed assassin. A microwave voice transmission non-lethal weapon is referenced in the thesaurus of the Center for Army Lessons Learned, which is a military instruction website, vidi infra for discussion of the analogously listed silent sound device. 19. An article from a magazine that publishes notably non-mainstream views details microwave inner voice device demonstration by Dr. Dave Morgan at a 1993 classified Johns Hopkins-sponsored non-lethal weapon conference, manufactured by Lockheed Sanders, and used by the CIA, who call the process voice synthesis or synthetic telepathy. Electromagnetic signatures of spoken words applied to the head at very low field levels, 1 microtor, affect word choice significantly along the emotional dimensions of the applied word. Though inspired by microwave hearing, this report is not of direct hearing. The author suggests that such an influence, even though weak, could shift the direction of group decisions in large populations, and has previously elaborated on the possibility of a less specific electromagnetic influence on populations. ++++++ Psychic spying through animals. The Navy has since the 40s or earlier tried to train dolphins as suicide bombers. Dolphins swim silently. Strapping a bomb to them and getting them to approach an enemy submarine or boat was the goal. They now have complete remote control of sharks to do this trick. However, one civilian researcher in EEG cloning amplified someone else's brain waves using magnetic coils to inject it into his brain. He could see a flashlight bright spot in his vision where the cloned subject was looking into a bright spotlight moving around. He felt really agitated during this experiment. He said he wouldn't try it again. He started doing research with EEG heterodyning with dolphins. That is all I could track as to his progress. Now, interestingly, Neuroscience magazine reported that with electrodes implanted in a cat's brain, they could decipher the visual cortex and display the cat's vision on a computer screen. It seems like a logical inference that you could then use animals' visual cortex to do spying too. What would it be like to try and map other species' minds onto a human, I wonder? Maybe we would all become vegetarians if we tried it and we could feel what other species feel. If not, we can still apply a consciousness metric to every species, including fetuses. We can then make an informed decision about the line we draw and what we can kill without remorse. The death doctors, as they are called, performed an experiment using an implanted cyberlink from a child to an ape. The experiment was to see if the ape would recognize the little child's mind and be calm when the child was put into the cage. The experiment failed and the child was killed immediately. Clearly, the DOD-funded death doctors were very interested in controlling animals and viewing through their mind or eyes with this line of research. Star Wars and Spa War. The division within the government that strategizes about space conflict is called Spa War, shortened from Space Wars. What many call science fiction, I know to be current science fact. It took the top DARPA scientists almost 5 years to figure out what the Russians were doing to the United States Embassy in Moscow. Clearly, the best scientists do not work for the Department of Defense. Earlier I described the disinformation campaign on destructive interference fringes called scalar waves by the Weapons Marketing Division. Keep this in mind. Let's perform some thought experiments in the tradition of Einstein. So here is the problem rephrased. If two wave fronts destructively interfere at the point of measurement, how can you separate the photons such that you can determine whether a destructive fringe is being measured from two interfering waveforms? With normal measuring equipment, it would read zero in both the electric and magnetic fields. A pinhole camera would block all but one path of the rays and reveal a single source of energy. A convex mirror would also separate the signal and amplify the very, very small angle of incidence. These are scalar detectors or scatter radar detectors. I leave the specifics of engineering one up to the reader. The other way to look at the problem is to view the sources from a radio telescope to get the resolution necessary to separate the very separate sources of the energy and pinpoint them. It would take a very large dish to do this. This makes you wonder if this is why we invest so much as a country into looking at the stars. Using pinhole photography techniques to resolve scalar energy can be difficult. The problem is that the frequency can be changed and hence the alignment of the holes would change. But that is the basic idea of how to turn an interference fringe, scalar gravity wave, into free energy. All this technology can be discovered by researching Russian translated documents, but so many of the ideas get lost in the verbatim translation. You need to understand the errors of translation between languages to get the nuances of the ideas. All the lies and propaganda makes one wonder if that perhaps through psychological warfare, that is propaganda, we have been persuaded to fight for the dark side of the force in the delusion that we are fighting for democracy and freedom. Beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I know that I am probably going into too much detail about the CIA mind control experiments, but one that I found particularly interesting is that they can determine what images and forms you find attractive. They can show you a sequence of people and determine through some brainwave response who you found attractive. This could be useful if they were to use an agent to try and extract information or gain confidence through intimacy. On a funny note, I was told that one characteristic that CIA field agents usually have is below average looks. The psychological advantage is that most people don't remember or stare at average or below average looking people, and hence it makes them more covert in their missions. The truth isn't nearly quite as glamorous as James Bond or Mission Impossible. One of the more advanced microwave hearing effect tricks. Phase angle segmentation of voice throwing. Imagine a bunch of soldiers surrounding a speaker listening to static, barely able to pick up their orders, which are cutting in and out, garbled intentionally by the electronic warfare jammers. Every listener will have a different angle relative to the speaker. It is possible to make every person hear different commands coming through the speaker. Several psychic soldiers could get them to argue over what was heard or get them all to do the wrong things in a disorganized fashion. How is this done? I was demonstrated this technique for an entire day and had many different theories how it was done at the time, but I am certain that the ventriloquism and bar trick is done this way. So an amusing spy game that was played with me, as a nice distraction from the torture, was an encoded message, one like I have never seen. I studied how to crack DAY and other encryption technologies, but had no real experience in the hacking techniques of the human mind before my ordeal. In secret government laboratories, the encryption keys are changed as frequently as can be cracked by the best decryption machines they have. The human brain cannot change its encryption, so once decoded, your brain is forever part of the TAMI database and network. The mind has no firewall. Using any noise source, specific frequencies from that source can be amplified perceptually. So, Encoding a voice pattern into a noise source is simply a matter of timing of the neuronal pathways that amplify the perception of the projected voice frequencies. In my research into FBI cases and interviews with government test subjects, it is obvious that any noise source can be used and in some cases not even necessary depending on the individual's brain amplification. I have read testimony that describes how refrigerators or even Rice Krispies would talk to test subjects. In my demonstration, I had a rainmaker/white noise generator running. It had a single speaker. The message was complex, patterned, and repetitive. I heard a sequence of four words which rotated through 10 other sets after each phrase was uttered in a poetic style. The phrases were, "Talk to your governor. I'll bring you coffee. I am the secretary. Now, raise a caucus. Dukakis went to Harvard. Join their cosmology department." This game got boring to me since I was not a spy and turned off by the cloak and dagger bullshit. I would walk away. At about 10 feet away from the noise source, the message became "Get back here." It was all computer generated. Later they explained the cloak and dagger game. The basic gist of the message was that the Secretary of Defense ordered these projects. All you can do is complain to your governor. Michael Dukakis maybe has a chance at running for president, but people who are familiar with the Kennedy assassination conspiracy and the mind control angle also know that Dukakis's run for presidency was interfered with using these directed energy mind control weapons. So the message is that it is even futile trying to change the government. At the time, I didn't understand the message to join the cosmology department completely. It is that this is all done by Star Wars technology, and a clue that stealth radar uses scalar waves which can only be resolved using a radio telescope. By rotating the sound source or by walking around the device, I would hear a different set of the four-word messages depending on my head orientation to the sound source. The real message could only be heard by walking from left to right after one word was uttered. There were four segmented phase angles with a different set of words that would be played in each. But the real messages could only be deciphered if you followed the word train in order through each segmented phase angle. The real message was encoded in a few of the diagonals of each set of word trains. This was just a spy game and the messages are irrelevant. It was only a test. Now let's look at the science behind the trick. Close your eyes and listen to your environment. You can pinpoint the location and direction of all the sounds. How does your brain know where sound is coming from? Bats are exceptionally good at locating objects based on sound. We have a type of sonar built into our auditory cortex. Using just tonal quality and the difference of timing of the sound waves hitting each eardrum, our brain creates a model of what and where the sound source is. Modern surround sound systems use the science to create virtual speakers and the perception of being immersed into a movie from all directions. By analyzing the brain waves associated with hearing and integrated at the base of the brain, one can determine the perceived sound direction of the source. The bare auditory test using traditional EEG probes placed behind the ear can pick up these neural pathways. From signal analysis, the phase angle of the sound sources is determined and segmented into groups. The predominant sound source is easily identified and depending on which phase angle segmentation is classified, a different computer-generated voice message is modulated into the neuronal amplification, and thereby the perception of frequencies. This is the crux of the ventriloquism act played on so many people. It is pretty obvious how voice throwing can be used to get someone to check out a false noise or voice and leave their post. Place diagram here of sound waves hitting each ear at slightly different times. Show EEG pattern collected and integrated at base of brain with timings. How direction of sound is perceived through this phase difference and neuron timing. Illusions of mind. Into the second week of my torture, I was told that most projects are terminated with car crashes or heart attacks. Although the microwave hearing effect is debilitating and very distracting, I actually consider myself lucky to have been told all the experiments before they happened or explained how they were accomplished while they were performing them. Most projects are never told and left confused or dead. After surviving the constant remote heart attack attempts, I had to be vigilant of the psychic assassination attempts through car crashes. There are the bland methods for automobile assassination such as hypnotizing the subject to run red lights, suddenly jerking their arms to steer off the road, putting them to sleep, or blinding their mind's eye to see an obstruction or approaching object, etc. But the more extreme and visually exciting method was discussed by Dr. Becker back in the early 1970s on the news. He said that this technology could be used to create visual perception errors to make airplane pilots crash, etc. JFK Jr.'s demise could have been caused in this way and assassinated like his father by the same shadow government. Princess Diana's demise could also have been caused by these weapons. Or maybe they were natural perceptional errors and misjudgments. In any case, I was shown how, during night driving, lights from oncoming cars, the road markers, or distant houses could be made to move around and appear in the foreground and in the background again. I was told this is accomplished by the psychic attacker synchronizing with the host's visual cortex strongly while they are in a dark room. They then shine a pinpoint flashlight and move it around in their own, the attacker's, eyes. What happens is the brain signals from the attacker are sent to the target and the target's visual cortex tries to make sense of the two competing signals, his own from the optic nerves and the attacker's. If you were able to see the secret message on the cover of this book, then you get a good sense how the brain will extract depth information from higher order patterns and can mismatch the data from each eye. You have taken the first step to being a psychic soldier. Silly, isn't it? But effective. So I gave them some improvements on their techniques because according to my research they haven't changed their methods much in 30 years. I despise inefficiency, waste, lack of creativity, and slow progress. Clearly I don't have a future in government. I suggested that they use a slide or hologram instead of a pinpoint light on their side. The hologram or slide could be images such as angels or demons' faces. I postulate that the target would see the subtle image in the light sources that his/her brain integrates with the attacker's. This would give the very spooky and eerie illusion that souls or ghosts were passing by on the road for each point source of light. The effect should be similar to that demonstrated in the movie Poltergeist. Maybe they already thought of this. They seemed excited about the possibilities to try it on their next project after I was dead. Sketch of